People often ask, what does success look like for you? Or what makes you successful? Fewer people ask, what does hope look like for you? Or what gives you hope? I've always been more enamored on the idea of hope than on the idea of success. Success is a culmination of the past, a collection of luck and work. But hope always looks towards the future. And not just any future, but the promise of a future that is almost impossibly better than our current reality. As a composer, I can't help but see hope in musical values. When you're scoring a film or a story, hope and redemption are such universal themes that there's just no way around it. You have to figure it out. And every composer is different. But we use four things to show this emotion: rhythm, harmony, melody, and instrumentation. Quicken the tempo of a tune, and it feels like a change is on the horizon. Change the note in a chord, and something that feels closed can suddenly open up and feel like there's something better around the corner. Even as something as simple as volume, or dynamics, as musicians call it, signals something to the listener. Something tentative and questioning can gradually, through a slow crescendo, build and become more confident, resilient, and commanding. Music's, you know, it's a funny thing. It's weightless. It has no scent. It's invisible. It has no temperature or moisture. Yet, when you hear it, it changes how you perceive your current situation, and it changes how you predict the future will turn out. 8 years ago, I started an orchestra called Magic Magic Orchestra. It's an orchestra based here in San Francisco, dedicated to collaborating with other artists. I started the group when I was 27, after a long and winding road towards music. When Sophia asked me to tell my story about how I got into music, it seemed appropriate to tell this story through the lens of hope, because hope's played a key role in how I got here, as I'm sure it has for many of you. Now, I can't tell my whole story, but I'd like to describe one moment in my life where the hope trajectory of my life changed dramatically towards where I am today. I'll start by sharing that story, and then we're going to retrace that story through a musical lens. So, what does hope sound like? For the purposes of this story, hope sounds like a waterfall. We're going to rewind back to 1986. I'm 5 years old. I'm at Niagara Falls with my mom, my dad, my grandparents, my aunts and uncles. Now, I'm a Berkeley native, but we had all come to the East Coast for my uncle's wedding. My uncle was my mom's baby brother, and he was the last to get married, so everyone was really excited. We'd all come in, and my grandparents, all the way from Korea, had come in as well. While we're there, we stopped by a cafe for lunch. And during the lunch, I began kind of playing with the ketchup and mustard on the table in a little bit of a strange way. I squirt the ketchup into my left hand and the mustard into my right hand, and I start rubbing my hands together, and my mom's kind of freaked out, and she's yelling at me like, what are you doing? Stop that. And I can't hear her. I'm kind of in like this weird trance. And she rips the bottles out of my hands, and the doctor who is at the next table kind of comes over and explains something to my mom. It's not that I'm throwing a tantrum, but I'm actually having a seizure. He asks her if this has ever happened before. And kind of with this deflated, saddened posture, my mom says, yes. I had been having them off and on since I was one. So eventually I kind of come out of this and we clean up the mess and my parents are pretty distraught, but we carry on with our vacation. During this time of my life, it's important to the story to know that we were pretty poor. My dad was a grad student at UC Berkeley. My mom stayed at home, so we were getting by on a pretty paltry TA salary. When my mom discovered my seizures, she started taking me around to all the doctor's offices that were kind of free and network in the system. But the prognoses were pretty poor. My family was told that if everything continued as it was without aggressive treatment, my seizures would get stronger and more frequent. As such, I would never be able to drive a car, never graduate from high school, or be able to hold down a job. Treatments were available, but they were very expensive. Prescriptions, EEG tests, CAT scans, doctor's visits, that all adds up, and that was kind of beyond my parents' means at the time. But something happened that day at Niagara Falls that changed the course of all of that, and it changed the hope levels in my parents' lives and also in mine. What happened? Well, on that trip was the first time my grandma was able to see me have a seizure in person. And she had kind of like heard through the grapevine that I was going out to hospitals and stuff, but she had never seen it. My grandparents were quite wealthy back in Korea, but I won't, you know, go into all the details, but the relationship between my mom and her mom, my grandma, were really strained. They weren't talking. But when my grandma saw in person the anguish and the pain that my seizures were causing my mom and my dad and how helpless they felt, it's like a switch flipped inside of her. Stubbornness runs really deep in my family, and an unfortunate side effect is that things like grudges and estrangement can kind of go on for years. But that day, pride was replaced with a kind of heartfelt empathy on the part of my grandma towards my family. And upon returning to Korea, she called my mom saying, "Don't worry about money, I'll help you." So with my grandma's help, my mom was able to get an appointment with Dr. Jean Hayward. She's one of the best pediatric neurologists in the Bay Area, and we began treatment. I was prescribed an anti-seizure drug called Depakote, which I took 3 times a day, every day for 7 years. I went to Kaiser every 2 weeks for my blood test. Lots of EEG scans and CAT scans, but ultimately the treatment was successful. With her help, I had my last seizure when I was 10, and I haven't had one since for 25 years. So that's the story. It's a moment in my life, and I wanted to share it because of the hope that it brought my family, and perhaps there's a story in your life also that this might remind you of. But we're here about music, so what about the music within the story? If someone handed me this story in a film and it wasn't about me and kind of told me to score it, the first thing I would do is I would scan the story for its hard turns or its edges. Stories and songs are kind of similar in that way. The most powerful part of a music cue are its edges, like when it starts, when it stops, and all the poignant moments in between where it sharply turns direction. These are kind of what I think of as edges in music, almost like a great crusty loaf of bread where like the burnt parts on the outside are more interesting. So when you look at a story, you have to pick out the important parts because you want to score those first and highlight those first, and you can kind of fill in the rest. The moments that stand out in this story were, number one, the beginning, because you want to establish a place and an environment and an expectation. The second was when the moment that the seizure happens, because that's the big turn. And the third was the phone call from my grandma, the kind of redemptive, hopeful moment. So the beginning starts pretty hopeful. You know, my mom told me that when you're a baby and before the doctor, she would wake up every morning tentatively hopeful that the seizures had gone away, because they had kind of mysteriously appeared when I was a little kid. Maybe they could just mysteriously disappear and we could just forget about the whole thing. So we begin our music on a tentatively hopeful note, a chord that maybe sounds something like this. So it's pretty good. But we are at a waterfall, so we want to give it a little bit of anticipation and a little bit of rhythm. It's better, but it's not quite there. So I'm going to change that duple rhythm that you heard to triplets. And we're going to pick up the tempo. Okay, so that's better, but it's a little Downton Abbey for my taste. So we're going to scratch that, and we're going to give that triplet motive to the vibes, and we're just going to have the strings hold a chord underneath. It's very close. We're just going to make one tiny adjustment, see if you can maybe notice the difference in sound. Right now, Robert is playing with hard mallets. We're going to have him change to softer mallets to give it a little bit more of a softer, more watery texture as opposed to like an icier texture like you're hitting glass. So that's better. So now we can start the story and set the scene. It's 1986, I'm 5 years old, we're at Niagara Falls, and everyone's having a pretty good time. So that's how it starts. But it doesn't stay that way long. Something happens in the middle of the story that kind of deflates it of its optimism. There's the turn where the seizure happens, but that's not where the music is going to climax. It's just where it's going to start to turn direction. From something a little more optimistic, to something a little more confused and dark sounding that gets more and more agitated as my family is confused and I'm doing this weird thing and no one knows what's happening. But finally the doctor steps in and we have our aha moment. What's really happening? Stopping music like I just did there, like a hard stop, is one of the most powerful moves you can make as a composer. When music suddenly becomes silent, the listener is forced to fill in that gap with their own thoughts, like breaking a trance. That sudden silence acts as a highlighter for the content that either came right before the silence or right after the silence. So I know where I want the music to stop, right before the doctor's reveal. But we have to build up to that, so that's when you start composing backwards. What series of chords are going to lead up to that sudden fall off? We could end on something like a tonic, but it's too final sounding, a chord like this. It's also too happy, so just kind of a little inappropriate for the moment. We need something more questioning. So in music, there's a chord that's considered the second to last chord of your song. It's called the five chord. It sounds something like this. You hear it in music all the time. But this chord is, as it is now, is too classical, kind of a little too, just too bright. So we're gonna change a couple notes to give it a little bit more darkness. So that's better. It's honestly a little too dark, but let's just like roll with it for a second. That's gonna be our last chord before the big cutoff. So here's our fourth chord. The third, the second, and the first. So that's out of order. So if we do it in order of our story, here's the first. Something's starting to go wrong at the lunch table, the second. And everyone's kind of getting into a panic and really confused. It has to get even more agitated. And then here's our last chord. Right before the doctor steps in, big crescendo, hard cut, and you feel the moment. The story stops, the tension deflates, and it's replaced by a kind of disappointing realization from my mom that this is still going on. But the story doesn't end there. There is that final upturn, like a welcome balm on a wound. It's the phone call from my grandma. It's nothing triumphant or overly melodramatic, but it's like a kind of like a burying the hatchet extended hand, an empathetic heart for one of your own. So just like a little piano should be fine, and then maybe some strings. To give it like a little glow. And we want the harmonies here to lean towards the future. A future that's better, because we want it to signal hope. So in the beginning of the story, hope sounded like a waterfall. But now hope sounds more like a comforting phone call. And all the while, music is there to show how rich and lovely hope can sound. Thank you.